Thank you for tuning in today. My name is Janne Schuyf, and on behalf of Canon Medical Systems Europe, welcome to the fifth and final day already of our Canon Online Cardiology Days. Today is all about sports. Our experienced panel is going to tackle all your questions about cardiac adaptation in response to exercise, and they will show you how they use the latest in imaging to better identify who is at risk for sudden cardiac death. It's my honor to introduce the moderator for tonight, Professor Schnell. He's a cardiologist and head of the Department of Sports Medicine at the University Hospital of Rennes in France. He's also a professor in physiology at the same university. He's a very frequent speaker and has published extensively on this topic, so we are very grateful to have him to guide the discussions today. Professor Schnell, the floor is yours.
Thank you. Thank you for this nice introduction. And thank you for all the attendance to be there. For the moment, we have nearly 100 people. So that's really nice that you have so many people. On the chat, we can see that you are all over from the world. That's very, very nice. So I want to thank Canon for this opportunity to make this session on sports cardiology. And I'm very happy to share this session with two experts in the field of sports cardiology and of in imaging. And so I will introduce the two speakers, but first, so don't hesitate to ask as many questions as you want. I will collect them during all the talks, and we will try to have a nice discussion at the end of the two talks. So the two talks are about imaging in sports cardiology. And the first speaker is Professor Marta Sitges, which is the director of the Cardiovascular Institute of Barcelona. And she's a really expert in imaging and in sports cardiology. So this first talk is about the challenge to identify myocardial pathology in athletes.
Thank you. Thank you very much for the nice introduction, Frederic. And thanks to Canon for the invitation and to having the opportunity to share this nice symposium with these two colleagues, experts in sports cardiology. So mainly I will talk on the challenge to identify myocardial pathology in athletes and why is this important. And I'm going to mainly focus on echocardiography because it's the first line imaging technique that we use for two reasons when we are doing a screening in athletes. First of all, for screening heart disease that might induce problems in the athlete. And when I'm talking about problems, I'm talking about putting in danger life of the athlete, so sudden cardiac death, but also to assess the impact of training on the heart. And sometimes we know that the training has an impact on the dimensions, the function of the heart, and sometimes it's difficult to differentiate which is normal in an athlete and when we are starting to face a real pathology, because the heart of the athlete remodels in a way that we are going to see now that sometimes resembles very much to dilated cardiomyopathy, right ventricular or hemogenic dysplasia, or left ventricular or hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. So the first question is to tell what is normal or abnormal in an athlete. And there are many review papers. I really recommend this one from our friend André Laguerre, where we try to put some cutoff values of normality, but as you can see, there is no one single parameter. Mainly what we know is that exercise training induces enlargement of the cardiac chambers, mild hypertrophy and balanced hypertrophy of both ventricles, which have lower limit systolic function. So everything is prepared for the heart to increase its performance during exercise when it's needed. This is how the heart adapts, because the heart adapts to need to increase its cardiac output. We can do that by increasing heart rate, of course, but we are more interested when we train to increase our stroke volume. And for that, we can increase the size of our chambers. This is why exercise induces enlargement of the cavities, but also increasing the deformation and the contractility of our heart. And these are things that we are currently able, and we have the tools to evaluate in each athlete with echocardiography. We can evaluate size, we can evaluate the formation of our cavities, and by integrating that, we can understand what's going on with the heart of the athlete. But also, there are important things to keep in mind apart from what we can see in imaging. First of all, we have to think on things that influence this cardiac remodeling of the athlete in response to exercise training. First of all, the type, the intensity and the type of the discipline of a sport the athlete is practicing. This is an example from two groups of our athletes. We compare swimmers and runners, and as you can see, there was a large variability and change in the size and in the function of the right ventricle in runners, which was not so extensive in swimmers. So the discipline also has an impact on how the heart adapts to exercise. Not all the exercises are the same. Once on the one hand, intensity, but also the type of discipline. Also, age and gender impact the remodeling that the athlete presents. And these are things that we have to integrate. Typically, young athletes have less remodeling on the one hand because the loads of training have been less accumulative because they are young. And also, we have observed, it has been observed that male usually remodel more and have more extensive remodeling as compared to female athletes. And also the impact, as I have said before, of the intensity and the load of the training, but also the effect of the training. This is a classical study where it was shown that with the training, the cavity, the size of the cavity of the left ventricle and the thickness were coming to reduced values, to baseline values before training in a group of athletes. So this is something always to integrate before when we are imaging these athletes and when we are seeing a very remodeled heart that we say, okay, is this pathology or not? We always have to keep in mind and integrate all these things. Another very important factor is race. We know that Afro-American athletes have much more remodel, as we will see in different scenarios. So let's go first to the case of left ventricular dilatation. This is an athlete of our site. This was a 36-year-old male who was asymptomatic. This was a routine checkup. He was running for more than 15 years. And as you can see here, there is balanced dilatation of the four cardiac chambers. And these are the volumes that we could measure in this patient with, as I have said, systolic function in the inferior limit. So is this dilated cardiomyopathy or is this just cardiac remodeling in response? Indeed, up to 35% of the athletes can have that what would be abnormal and diastolic dimensions of the left ventricle. And even in more selected patients, they can have ejection fractions even below 50%. One of the things that has been useful to distinguish and helps us in distinguish normal or physiological adaptation and normal dilatation as compared to dilated cardiomyopathy is the response of the heart during exercise. And this has been studied with echocardiography and also with cardiac MRIs in this study from the Loven group, where they show that healthy individuals, they increase, healthy endurance athletes increase the ejection fraction while during exercise, and these occur much less and very similar to those athletes who had also fibrosis. So using exercise echocardiography or another type of exercise imaging, as well as a complementation with the evaluation of myocardial fibrosis, can help distinguishing the dilatation of the left ventricle of these athletes with very extensive dilatation of the left ventricle beyond 60 or 65. But again, depending on the race, depending on the size of the body of the athlete, depending on the type of exercise they are performing, and depending on the intensity. Another problem that we face many times, which is non-compaction myocardium. This is something that we are seeing more and more, even more when the echo machines are getting with much, providing much better quality images. So it has been described that up to 8% of elite athletes may show this non-compaction myocardium, that that they are in accordance with the criteria of Jenny. So they have large non-myocardium as compared to compacted myocardium. So what to do in these athletes? We also know that this can be present in athletes. We know that's more frequent also in Afro-American athletes, also in male, and even in healthy individuals. And this is data from three large population studies where it was where non-compaction myocardium or hypertrabeculation was present in more than 15% of the healthy population. So fortunately, we have long-term follow-up, more than 10-year follow-up in these large populations. And we have learned that this hypertrabeculation, when it goes with normal systolic and diastolic function, and there is no latent hazement on the cardiac MR, we know this is related to a benign prognosis, and indeed we should keep on training these athletes. We just keep an eye on them, we just perform them annual screenings with imaging, but we let them to compete perfectly, because this is another feature or cardiac adaptation to training. Let's go to the case of left ventricular hypertrophy. So let me share with you this case. This was a 42-year-old male, Caucasian. He had a spinal cord injury after a car accident, and he was a wheelchair basketball player. This was a routine checkup. He had no symptoms. Sorry for the quality of the ECG, which is not that good, but as you can see, there were maybe a little bit of incomplete RVV, as usual in many athletes. Maybe criteria for Sokolov here of hypertrophy, but we know that these criteria don't work in many athletes, okay? But in imaging, as you can see, there was a concentric hypertrophy of, you, as you can see here, of the life of the left ventricle, and the measurement of the interventricular septum was 14 millimeters. So is this physiological? Is this adaptation to training in this athlete, or is this an early form of hypertrophic cardiomyopathy? In this, we know that this is frequent also in athletes, particularly in Black athletes. This is data from classical studies from the Italian group, but also here in Barcelona, we have similar results. And in this athlete, what we did, of course, we look for diastolic function. The athlete had 42-year-old, a slight abnormal relaxation, but for a 42-year-old athlete is not that frequent, but not so abnormal. And then we went to the formation imaging. So we scanned the patient, and we did a speckle tracking on the left ventricle, and we observed how was the deformation of the different segments. And as you can see here, there is a clear post-systolic thickening here that it's involving mainly the basal segment of the septum, which is a very frequent pattern in that it's demonstrative of increased afterlunate, and it's very frequent in hypertension. So indeed, the formation imaging is useful to distinguish different underlying etiologies of myocardial hypertrophy. And typically in hypertension, we have this pattern of post-systolic thickening with very normal strain, as you can see, of the other segments, very homogeneous deformation of the different segments, and very timely with normal peak values, and only this post-systolic located in the basal septum. So typically in a healthy individual, we have this homogeneous deformation of the of the different segments of the left ventricle, which is not the case in a hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, because due to fiber dysarray, we have areas of very, very abnormal deformation, as you can see here in the basal septum and even in the mid septum, as compared to very normal deforming areas in the apex or in the lateral wall. In the athletes, we have normal deformation, as you can see, very similar to a healthy individual. And sometimes even with training, there is even more in the apex, as you can see here, as compared to the base. So mainly we have, again, this normal pattern of the formation. So in hypertension, as the athlete that I have shown before, we have typically an increased thickness of the septum. In the case of our athlete, it was more the concentric LVH, LV hypertrophy, but typically this post-systolic in the basal septum appears because it's the area where it's more flat, there is more wall stress, and it appears this post-systolic thickening, which is very indicative that there is increase afterload. So the patient, the athlete, was recommended to check for hypertension and to even during the exercise test. So we recommended to control his hypertension. This is another example of another athlete, 16-year-old. He was Caribbean, he was a football player, completely asymptomatic. And again, in his echocardiography, we find this also quite concentric, but maybe more septal hypertrophy. Septum measure was 14 millimeters. This is his ECG. Maybe some abnormalities here, but this was a very young athlete. So this elevation of the J point is something that sometimes we also see in these patients. Maybe D3, there was some abnormality here, but what was really helpful for us to distinguish was, again, using the formation analysis of the left ventricle. So as you can see here, there are areas here like with quite normal deformation, the red, which corresponds, on the left side now. So in the lateral wall, which is quite normal, while the mid septum, as you can see, was very, very abnormal with very reduced abnormal deformation. And this is a typical pattern, very inhomogeneous, very typical from hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. So the athlete was counseled not to play, and later on, the genetic study confirmed hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. Let's move to the right ventricle of the athlete, which sometimes always poses some problems to us. This is a 39-year-old male endurance athlete practicing running for more than 15 hours per week. And if you go to his echocardiography in the short axis, he has a dilated RVOT, dilated base of the right ventricle. And these criteria are indeed very, very suggestive and in accordance with the criteria of right ventricular dysplasia. But indeed, we know that up to 40% particular endurance athletes have these minor criteria for right ventricular dysplasia, and even 1/4 of them might have reduced systolic function of the right ventricle. So typically what we have in athletes is a dilatation of the base of the right ventricle and a hypertrophy of the apex, as you can see in these two athletes, okay? So, but it is true that some athletes have a very marked remodeling here, while others have much more normally appearing right ventricles. Also, the formation can help a little bit to distinguish. Most of the athletes have normal healthy people, which are not athletes, we see the same. We see, again, like we did in the left ventricle, we see homogeneous deformation. And typically the base has, as it is larger, it has slightly slower deformation strain as compared to the apex. This is somehow enhanced in some athletes, okay? So there is kind of this gradient, and that happens because the base is more dilated, so we have larger size, so the formation is smaller. So we have this typical feature in the athlete, but also in arrhythmogenic cardiomyopathy of the right ventricle, we have even lower values of a strain or the myocardial deformation. So that's another tool that might help us to look at this pattern between the gradient on the base and the apex, and also the absolute values of the formation. Also, exercise pathology, and I am sure that Dr. Pieles will develop more on this, might help looking at the response of the right ventricle. And this is another work from the Belgian group and from Andrea Gertz, where they showed that these athletes who have ventricular arrhythmias coming from the right ventricle and they have diseased right ventricles don't show this improvement in right ventricular function while exercising, while athletes with without ventricular arrhythmias and even healthy people, normal response is to increase the formation and motion of the right ventricle. So this exercise testing with any imaging associated might be also of help. Finally, we have to keep in mind that apart from integrating the race, the age, the gender, the discipline, sport discipline, the intensity of the training load and everything, we have to combine these imaging parameters. As we said, for example, with hypertrabeculation, we need to know that if hypertrabeculation, if systolic motion is function is normal, diastolic function is normal, probably it's not that's not pathology, it's just another feature adaptation, and the athlete is going to be good. Okay. So again, when we are looking at the formation, we have to combine that with the size. So if we have a larger size of the ventricles, and these are data from another group of our athletes, if we look at the left ventricle or the right ventricle, we compare athletes with controls. Here in the right ventricle, for example, here we have a strain, here we have the size. So for larger sizes of the right ventricle, strain goes lower, because in the end, it's a combination. Stroke volume is a combination of both. But if we have a very large if we have a small cavity, so not so enlarged right ventricle, for example, with a very low right ventricular deformation or strain, we have to think that there is something wrong there. If the ventricle is enlarged and the strain is reduced, that may be physiological, because for a larger cavity, we need less deformation of the cavity. So to sum up, and this is my concluding slide, we really need to have a comprehensive assessment of the athlete's heart. We have definitely, with echocardiography, simple available method, we have an added value of the formation imaging. Exercise also can help, and particularly integration of all these parameters, the imaging parameters, but also integrating the characteristics of the discipline, the type of sport, the training loads, the race, and the gender of the athlete. This will help us in differentiating these difficult gray zones, and also help us in monitoring the impact of training on cardiac performance through the years of the athlete that is training. Of course, we are learning every day, and we need much more outcome studies, but definitely we have the tools. We need to combine them, so let's use it. Thank you very much for your attention.
So thank you, Marta, for this excellent presentation. We will now move on exercise echocardiography with Guido Pieles, who is also a specialist in imaging and in sports cardiology, and he has also a special focus on on adults and pediatric congenital cardiology. So he will now speak about how the stress echo can help in understanding the athlete's heart.
Good evening to everyone at this Canon Sports Cardiology webinar, and a big thank you, of course, to Canon for organizing this and for the invitation. Apologies that this is a pre-recorded talk, but I will be available online for the question and answer session later. You will have surely heard a fantastic talk, as always, from Marta Sitges from Barcelona, and I would like to talk here about a novel modality that is exercise imaging, which we have been using more and more frequently indeed to decipher early pathology. This is my disclosure slides, but most importantly gives you a professional background, how I've been involved and where in sports cardiology over the last years. When we decipher or try to decipher early pathology in young athletes, and we are faced with these images, the upper panel is a healthy 15-year-old boy, no elite athletes, but maybe active playing footy twice a week. And at the bottom panel, we see a left ventricle of a elite athlete with more than 10 hours training per week plus competition. And you can see there is mild remodeling. You might need to take my word for it, but the short axis view shows mild hypertrophy and maybe some dilatation. And this is all good, and we can differentiate between those two, but more important is to differentiate between these two images. And we've got the same athlete in the upper panel again. And at the bottom panel, this is the echocardiogram left ventricle of a sub-11, 16-year-old 100-meter sprinter. This is world-class for this age. And this sprinter has a beginning hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. As you can see, there is a marked hypertrophy and no great dilatation of the left ventricle. So later, this athlete was diagnosed with hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. However, it is very difficult to diagnose this, to spot this. And we are looking for new tools to make our diagnostic process more sensitive and more specific. Why is this necessary? As you know, we are dealing with a gray zone here. We do get a cardiac adaptation due to exercise in healthy individuals, even in adolescents. This is due to types of sports, volume of training, but also ethnicity, body size, gender, age, and all these factors play a part. But of course, then there's also the more dangerous adaptations that are cardiomyopathies. And these can mimic a healthy adaptation, and we need to find out how to differentiate it. And as I say, we're dealing with a gray zone because often these hypertrophic left ventricular non-compaction dilated or arrhythmogenic cardiomyopathies in athletes are not so-called barn door cases where we have clear signs that are written in a textbook. Often athletes that are healthy and athletes that have a beginning cardiomyopathy, they usually present in the gray zone where these two phenotypes overlap. Recent paper published from our FA data in the UK showed that, in fact, the sudden cardiac death events that happened after screening of 16-year-old footballers, and these were over 11,000 footballers that were screened, structural abnormalities such as hypertrophic cardiomyopathy were the most common culprit and cause. And you can see this here. Despite screening by ECG and echocardiogram, and again, despite for the paper blindly reviewing these echo scans and ECG scans again, many of these young athletes who sadly died would not have been picked up by a resting ECG and a resting echocardiogram. And the hypothesis of our research group and also others was some years ago, why don't we image during exercise? Because remember, 50% of sudden cardiac death in hypertrophic cardiomyopathy in athletes happens during exercise or around the time of exercise. So we want to find out, is there anything we can pick up during exercise in athletes when we test them that might help us to risk predict for sudden cardiac death? And this is really the gold standard. We want to find out, what is the difference between a resting left ventricle, between a left ventricle during mild exercise, and between a left ventricle at peak exercise? What happens there? And the magic word here is cardiac reserve. Is the cardiac reserve normal? Does contractility, myocardial function, cardiac output increase during exercise? And excess stress echo obviously has been induced in ischemic heart disease for a long time, but the problem is, and this was recognized early, it is expert dependent. Because if you look qualitatively at warm motion abnormalities and such things, you need to be an expert. If you're not, your sensitivity is very low. André Laguerche and his group have, however, shown that if we use modern myocardial deformation imaging, if we use strain imaging, we can actually, during exercise, get reliable data. And this was a game changer, and we've been using strain and strain rate imaging for a long time. Of course, it is not easy to do, and I will show you why, because of course, heart rates are higher. However, the recent document, and this is one to read if you're interested, the recent document on imaging in athletes, this has come out in 2017, does mention that firstly, strain imaging should be part of the assessment, but also that exercise imaging is a secondary diagnostic tool in this athlete group. Well, what does it look like? Well, we can image the ventricle at rest, as you can see on the left-hand panel, or during exercise. And we do this when we use strain with longitudinal strain, but more importantly, I would say with circumferential strain, because during exercise, and I will show you data what we have obtained, that the circumferential myocardial performance contraction is much more pronounced and more important during exercise. However, longitudinal strain is our most commonly used clinical tool. And you can see here in an athlete, firstly, there is normal increase in strain, and the papers below show you that we do have normative values in adolescent young people and in adolescent athletes. So we can actually compare our individual clinical strain images during exercise and values to published data. And also what you see often is here that there is no dyssynchrony. All strain curves of all segments are synchronous. And this is very important. I will show you one example at the end where this is not the case in an athlete. In the athlete assessment, exercise stress echocardiography can, of course, be combined with other exercise testing methods. And we do this routinely as it is a very time-efficient investigation that also gives you a lot of data to get a comprehensive and an in-depth picture of the cardiovascular system during exercise. We usually do a VO2 max during this test, as you see here, and a stress ECG as well. When should it be used? Well, if the ejection fraction is less than 52%, then we usually do a stress echocardiogram to see if the cardiac reserve is there during exercise. Also, if there are wall motion abnormalities, or if there's any suspicion of an underlying inherited cardiac conditions. And recently, more and more, we have been doing it if there's a suspicion of myocarditis. And as you can see here, we combine this, as said, with the VO2max, but we also measure the oxygen muscle metabolism using near-infrared spectroscopy. And this works well in patients with congenital heart disease, for example, where the saturation and the muscle oxygenation is sometimes impaired. Importantly, we can also assess the right ventricle, and this is particularly important when we talk about arrhythmogenic cardiomyopathy. And we have evaluated and validated RV strain during exercise in one of our papers. What does the data show us? Well, we look at myocardial performance in two planes. One is the longitudinal dimension and the other one the circumferential dimension. And as you can see in the upper panel, in the longitudinal dimension, strain as a surrogate for myocardial performance increases first, but during higher intensity of exercise and near maximal exercise, this levels out. Whereas in the lower panel, it's circumferential contraction, myocardial performance continues up to the end of exercise. And this is a very important physiological data that is also backed up by invasive data, particularly from the Leuven group in the 2000s, but also Bart Beenens from Barcelona confirms that circumferential contraction of the heart during exercise is the predominant mechanism how the heart can increase cardiac output. On the right side, you see strain rate, and this is less load dependent than strain as such. And there is a continuous increase in contractility. So this is an important relationship to have in mind. And this is here depicted again as the strain reserve. And you see longitudinal strain increases less than circumferential strain. And this is important also for discussing these values in cardiomyopathy, as longitudinal strain is often earlier impaired in hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. What we did as well was we tried to differentiate between athletes and non-athletes. And here you see data from adolescents, age matched. The gray is the athlete cohort and in black the non-athlete healthy volunteer cohort. And you can see why the strain values at rest in athletes are lower because of better vascular compliance during exercise. The cardiac reserve in athletes is much more pronounced, and this is true for both longitudinal and circumferential strain. We've done this in adolescent athletes at Manchester United Academy, but also FC Barcelona Academy. And these results are published now in the European Journal of Applied Physiology. But of course, most important is what happens when we do exercise stress echocardiography in patients with pathology, in particular in patients with inherited cardiomyopathies. And here we have data besides our normative data and healthy volunteers from the group at Sitges in Toronto. And Luke Mertens and Barbara Sifra have investigated this in adolescents with hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. And as you can see here, why the strain in the septum at rest is similar in volunteers that are healthy and in patients with hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. During exercise stress, you can see that the septum of patients with hypertrophic cardiomyopathy does not increase contractility or myocardial performance, and strain does not increase. So this is very important information. Unfortunately, this is not published yet. What has been published recently is a paper by Sanjay Sharma's group from London, and they have investigated athletes and patients with dilated cardiomyopathy during exercise, and you can clearly see the left ventricular ejection fraction in athletes increases with good cardiac reserve during exercise. But in patients with dilated cardiomyopathy, it does not. Ejection fraction is being used here. I said before that I have some reservations about this, as ejection fraction is very much load dependent, and I think strain is a more elegant and more directly reflective way of the myocardium. It is, however, also important to look at patients and indeed athletes with congenital heart disease. And the new position paper from the European Society of Cardiology does indeed show that with a detailed assessment pathway in athletes with congenital heart disease, exercise imaging has to play a role and does play a role, as you can see. And we've carefully formulated this pathway and have indeed included exercise as a core component. Why is this? I will show you now at the end of my talk several pictures of two athletes with congenital heart disease. They have all been diagnosed in infancy with tetralogy of Fallot and had their correction of this defect. And you might know what tetralogy of Fallot is. There's a right ventricular outflow obstruction. There's also a ventricular septal defect, right ventricular hypertrophy, and an overriding aorta. What you can see here on the left side is a footballer who has a dilated right ventricle, but his function and his exercise tolerance is good. On the right side, there's a tennis player, same diagnosis. His ventricle is not so dilated. The footballer on the left does complain, however, that over the last 3 to 6 months, he has noticed that his exercise tolerance is down a little bit. And with a discerning eye, you will be able to see on the left side, firstly, in the apical for chamber view, that the right ventricle is dilated, although the function is not too bad, reduced clearly, but we would accept this in tetralogy of Fallot. But there's also septal flattening in the parasternal short axis view, which means the pressures are high. This is not the case on the right side. We exercise both of these patient athletes, and you can clearly see while on the right side, the tennis player has a normal response to exercise. On the left side, the right ventricle dilates significantly further, and particularly at the apex, and the apical regional function is clearly, clearly very, very reduced with dilatation and wall motion abnormalities. We can also quantify this, and we did do this, and in fact, we did use strain. And while you can see that on the right side, there's an RV exercise strain of 23.4, and this is just about normal. It should be above clearly 22, up to 30 we get in healthy volunteers. On the left side, there's not only a reduced overall strain, you can also clearly see a disynchrony because of the pressurized right ventricle, that the lateral wall of the right ventricle contracts much, much later. And this RV dysfunction during exercise clearly, clearly is the case for the exercise symptoms. this football player, and it does not only affect the right ventricle, no, it affects the left. Again, on the right, you see the tennis player with tetralogy fallow with a better ventricle, with synchronous contractility, with normal exercise strain, whereas on the left, you can see a flattening septum, but you can also see dyssynchrony on the strain curves with much later contractility of the septal areas. And this exemplifies nicely that strain during exercise gives us a quantitative assessment with and offers a lot of insight also in the etiology, what is going on. We have been pushing exercise imaging with our partners, FC Barcelona, Man United and Aspire Academy, with the help of Canon, to bring this not only into the daily practice with athletes, but also with children with congenital heart disease. And in Bristol, where I work in the Congenital Heart Center, we are doing this assessment during exercise, pre-op, or if any therapy changes need to be considered. This is all I wanted to say. In summary, exercise imaging in the athlete is an important tool, and particularly overall quantitative imaging is a very accurate assessment that we need in screening athletes, but also in following up athletes with possible pathology. Strain imaging in particular is less load dependent. It can give you knowledge on the not only on the global but also on regional function, wall motion abnormalities, and also synchrony or dyssynchrony, where more and more we've been using as strain imaging, and particularly as it gives you a quantitative picture. Of course, one scan is not enough. We see these athletes on an annual basis, sometimes even 6 monthly, because the longitudinal change in function is often subtle but can be picked up if longitudinal assessments are performed. And of course, as I say, it's not only strain imaging during exercise that will give us a diagnosis. We need to have an integrated approach, and often this will include also an MRI scan, at rest, exercise testing, cardiopulmonary exercise testing, stress ECG, and also mobile ECG monitoring. This is all I would like to say. I'm looking forward to your questions later in the evening. Thanks to all the people mentioned here, and particularly to Canon Medical Systems, who have really helped us develop these methodologies with their expertise and, of course, with their equipment. As said, 10 years ago, it was not possible to get these beautiful pictures during exercise, but now it is. Thank you very much for your attention.
So thank you, Guido, for this nice images and for this nice talk on exercise echocardiography. So now we can move on the questions. So Guido, we can still not hear you. So maybe, so perfect.
Good evening. Hello, Frederick. Nice to see you.
So there are many questions already. So the first question might be, do you think that now we are ready to give normal values for athletes, or do you more look at the pattern of the strain? Is it more complex than only a value? So that's a question for both of you, because you both spoke about strain. So I would be happy to have your opinion on that.
Well, should I start, Guido?
Please, Marta. Hello, good evening. Yes.
Hello, nice to see you. So as I have said, Frederick, I think there is no perfect single cutoff parameter. So I don't think we can rely. Of course, there are very abnormal values and very normal values. But in the middle, there is a gray zone that depends a lot of many things. And I have tried to show that. No, so a single value of the formation, 20%, let's say, or 17% longitudinal strain. So that depends on the size of the chamber we are evaluating, and also the size and the performance of the heart depends on what we have said, no? On the discipline the athlete is doing, on the training load. So I think it's much more complex than one single parameter. I think we have to put all together, no? So if you see, I don't know, 14 millimeter septum in a black male or a non-compaction myocardium in a black athlete, I mean, maybe that's probably normal. If you see it on a lady doing, I don't know, 2 or 3 days per week a sport, probably that's not normal. So it depends. We have to make everything together. Guido, I don't know if I left something for you. Do you want to add something?
No, well, you're right. It's even more true for exercise imaging, where there are no cutoff values yet. But what we have and others have shown, and I've shown you in the talk, is that cardiac reserve needs to be there, which means the myocardial performance contractility needs to increase during exercise. And that's what we don't see in cardiomyopathies. And this is extremely important. So it is an individual assessment, which then can lead to a comparison to invest in exercise. And if indeed there's no increase in cardiac function, myocardial performance, then this is always a red flag. And this is important. The other thing I think is very important to look with strain at regional warm motion abnormalities. What we would need, and I'm sure Frederick, as an international expert in cardiac MRI, and athletes would want me to say it, we would need the correlation with MRI and also with MRI strain, because MRI is the gold standard, particularly in subtle wall motion abnormalities during, for example, early cardiomyopathies or even myocarditis. So I think we need to do more study to correlate these two modalities.
Yes, thank you. Yeah, I found it really interesting to make this comparison with the size of the cavity and the strain, because that's what we know with ejection fraction, that if the heart is bigger, we should not be so surprised that it's beating not so good. And that's something I was not used to do with strain. So that's an excellent point, an excellent idea to use that. Do you think that it might also be, because we only spoke about diagnosis, because that's probably the most important in the athlete, to make sure that he's healthy or not, is it physiological or pathological? Do you think that there might one day be a place of these imaging techniques to make a better risk stratification in some athletes, for example, in HCM? Or do you think that it's really a tool for diagnosis and not for risk stratification?
I start. I think it's going to be a useful tool also, no? So you know, there is a strong controversy on the allowance for exercise practice or not in HCM now. So I think, this is another tool to stratify these patients, no? As it is fibrosis in MR, as it is obstruction. So I think the formation has the big advantage that you can you have the tool on your echo, and that sometimes you have to decide with the athlete, it's there and you don't have time to go for the MR and check for fibrosis, etc. So I think first of all it's a very useful tool as a first step, because you have it there and you make quick decisions. So like the athlete, the young boy I told you, it was a Friday evening and we had to decide if on Sunday he was playing or not. I had no time to make an MR, sorry. Of course we can do it later on, but that helps, I think. And as I have said, I think that we have to combine also the information. I mean, I'm not saying, oh, cutoff point of a strain less than 15, we are not going to allow him to play, or he has high risk. I don't think this is going to happen. I think it's a combination and integration with MR, with exercise for sure. But I think these tools, yes, they are going to be able, not for the diagnosis, they are going to be helpful for the prognosis, the risk stratification. I am absolutely sure.
So yes, what I would say, it's not only a diagnostic tool. I feel within the limits, there's, you know, none of these investigations is a single gold standard tool to discover pathology. But we are using exercise imaging as well in following up disease. Risk stratification means we have a validated risk score. And we have a correlation to outcome, and we don't have this yet. So, but of course, Frederick aside, this would be the ultimate goal. But I would also like to say that we can see subtle changes, and this is anecdotal, but we have seen, for example, change in cardiac reserve during excess stress pre-season and post-season. So when players have really played the whole season in Premier League football and are fatigued, we can see mild changes. So that is important as well. And the other thing I wanted to say, looking at the questions and answers, of course, it is age dependent. It is also sports dependent. So we need to learn much more about this. I think we are not quite there yet, but we need to gather more data. But it looks exercise imaging is a promising tool to be yet another weapon in our arsenal to complement resting echo cardiac MRI as such.
Absolutely.
And another question. Of course, you will look at the strain when the athlete is abnormal or in the gray zone, but would you recommend to perform it in every athlete, even if there's no other sign of any cardiac abnormality on the clinics, ECG, echo? You would recommend to do it at every time?
Or is it strain imaging or exercise? Yes. Exercise
no, imaging. That's for the question. That's for a later question. But for the rest, strain imaging.
Yeah, Marta, what do you say?
You have it, you will do it.
I think it takes 30 seconds to do it. With the current tools now, it's on the machine. You can do boom, boom. It's super quick. Why not?
That's a good answer.
Yeah, it's easy. So if you have to transfer the echo to an outside computer, open another program. I mean, of course, if it takes time, it's much. You just do it for the ones that you really need it. But if you have on your echo machine, which is the usual thing now, why not? It's 30 seconds. It's just a four-chamber view, and you have a lot of information. And then, of course, you can do on the others, but just on a four-chamber view, I think it gives you a lot of information. And also, it's a good way to train. It's a good way to train because when you need it, you need to really understand and get good traces and understand what's happening, what's going on. So if you just do for the difficult cases, usually it doesn't work.
Yes, of course. I had a question on strain in exercise echocardiography. Do you are able to do it even at peak exercise, or do you make it only at the maximal exercise because after that the heart rate is too fast? Or are you able to do it even at the peak?
Yeah, so that's an important question. As you've seen from my talk, we like to quantify the exercise test. I know exercise echo is being done in ischemic heart disease, and often the heart rate is put up to 80% of max, and then images are taken. And then if at all, they're not often quantitative measurements are taken, but we would like to quantify it. I want to know where's the athletes, particularly where's the anaerobic threshold. This is more of a research question, but it is quite true that during the anaerobic threshold, the heart is working normally on fatty acids. So there's a change and shift to glycolysis, and this might be very important for pathology. However, of course, there are technical limitations. If you've got a heart rate of 180 and you've got a frame rate of 60, then you've got too few frames a second to capture enough images in systole to get good strain curves. However, the frame rates we are getting here are often 90 to 100 frames per second, which leaves you 20, 30 frames per systole. So you can actually get reliable strain values. And of course, we've verified this, and we've looked at the observer even variability. And we think we can do this up to 150, 160 beats per minute. But of course, the image quality is not always there. And this is important. And we shouldn't delude ourselves and just do strain on every image. If it's not good enough, it's not good enough. And that's particularly true for the right ventricle, where the lung come much more into play at higher exercise. So this is a bit of an art. One has to image really an expiration when the athlete expires, and then you can get two, three cardiac cycles. But yes, it is still a limitation, and we I would not say that this does not cloud the picture a little bit. But I think it's also wrong to say exercise imaging doesn't work, which often was said 10 years ago, because of this phenomenon. I mean, many, many research groups have shown that it is possible to get reliable data and we should use it.
Okay, thank you. And as regards to the indications of stress echocardiography, there is a question from the audience about the usefulness of stress echocardiography after COVID in case of an athlete who had a COVID. Do you think it might be interesting in order to unmask a subclinical myocarditis?
That's an interesting question, of course. You know, we have done it. I have two cases where, in fact, we've seen very mild wall motion abnormalities. Overall strain is not reduced unless it's a severe myocarditis, and then one would pick it up in ECG and other parameters, also stress imaging. But we have seen it in two athletes. However, I would not only rely on it. Of course, gold standard is the MRI scan, so they should always have an MRI scan. But we have seen subtle wall motion abnormalities, which were confirmed, by the way, on MRI scan afterwards in the same segments that we picked up during exercise echo screening for myocarditis. But I think it is a valuable additional tool, but we haven't got the hard data out to confirm this.
And you spoke a lot about circumferential strain. You think it's easier or better probably than longitudinal strain? What would you recommend to perform everything you can, or what would you rely more on?
Yeah, so we've really optimized our protocols. For example, of course, we all know radial strain is out of the arena. There's a high inter-observer variability, and it also does not correspond to the muscular layers in the heart, so it's not physiological. What we found is that practically circumferential strain is much easier to obtain during exercise in a short axis view, but also, as I said, from our data and also from other data, even on animal data, circumferential movement, short axis movement, is the predominant movement of the left ventricular myocardium during exercise, whereas longitudinal movement, as I've shown, levels out at higher exercise stages. And also, that is very important that we see in certain cardiomyopathies, as I've shown you, the unpublished data from Toronto, that circumferential strain can pick up as longitudinal strain, but can also pick up changes in early hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. So I would, if I had to choose one, I would do circumferential strain. In fact, I would do it in three layers. And of course, then we could also do rotation twist, which has not been studied enough during exercise, but we know from resting data from cardiomyopathy that particularly in young people, gene-positive hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, that's data from Toronto, from John Forsey, who's shown that gene-positive young adolescents with early hypertrophic cardiomyopathy have an abnormal twist, an abnormal circumferential movement before any other signs become apparent.
Okay. And you showed us nice images with VO2 max and exercise echo. Do you do it now in every patient, or when will you choose to do it?
That depends a bit on the setup, but there's a big criticism that VO2 max on a reclining bike, and you know this best, your group is leading in this area, that it doesn't give you the same values. It is probably 10-12% lower, but as long as you know this and you take this into account and you put a factor onto it, then I think a maximal test is a maximal test. And of course, in athletes, this is also a very time-efficient test. We can do a stress echo, stress ECG, and VO2 max in 25 minutes. So we do this. We have also started to correlate VO2 max with strain. And this goes back to my sentence that, for example, hypertrophic cardiomyopathy is in some respects also a metabolic disease. So metabolic cardiac cardiac energy depletion. This is an idea that has come out from the Oxford group around Hugh Watkins, who say that in hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, the risk for sudden cardiac arrest increases as you become more anaerobic during exercise. Of course, if you do a VO2 peak with this strain, we will have, and we have PhD students working on this, to correlate strain with oxygen consumption.
Yeah, thank you. That's very interesting. Now I'm trying to do it also when I do my exercise echo, but you still don't know if you should it do at each time. And if you're in a research group, you will do it because you want to make research. But of course, if you are a clinician cardiologist, you might maybe not want to do it at each time.
So, yeah, but it might be of help when you have doubts. So I think it's good. When sometimes it can help on difficult decisions. No, we don't do it routinely, but I think the approach is interesting because in some patients, difficult patients, I mean, it might be of help, I think.
Yeah, and I completely agree with the fact that the exercise, the peak VO2 max will be lower because he's sitting, he's not on a real bike. And I saw that at each echo that they do less than when they are on the normal bike. But of course, it would be interesting to have normal values for this kind of exercise. And that might be really interesting and to have a better idea of what's normal or not. So maybe the last question about cardiac reserve, which is really important. It's the same. Do you have a cutoff value with either ejection fraction or with strain? Do you have any advice to give to the cardiologists who are listening to us?
You can chip in yourself as well, Marta. We usually use for ejection fraction. Often athletes with a low normal ejection fraction or even lower, of, as I've said, 52, below 52, we do exercise echoes. This should go at least go up by 10%. So we should have a normal ejection fraction of 58 to 60%. Often it goes up higher. With strain, we have shown that the increase with strain is as well during exercise in adolescent athletes usually is at 10 to 20%. At the minimum of 10, 15% is mean 20% increase in strain during exercise. So this would be the values we really use. But again, we have not, I'm cautious here because we have not large enough data mass to call these normative values. Yeah, there are reference values maybe to be guided by, but the data sets are not big enough yet.
Yeah, I agree. So I think we need more data, but typically contractile reserve as for increase in ejection fraction between 10 and 20%. For a strain, I guess it's more or less the same. But again, it will depend on the size of the chamber. As we said, the strain won't increase so much if you have a large ventricle or not. But I think by 10, 20% should be normal. But again, let's go to 19, not 19, 9%. Is it abnormal or depends, no? So these gray zones are the difficult ones, always.
So thank you very much. We are now out of time. We will have to conclude. There were still many other questions, but it's difficult to give an answer to all of them. I think one of the most important also was to speak about an integrated approach. Of course, this session was on imaging, and of course we spoke a lot about imaging, but everyone you both told us nicely that we don't only look at the images, but also at the history, at the symptoms, at the ECG. On all your cases, you showed us an ECG. And of course, then we go to imaging and to exercise imaging. So thank you very much for your talks, and thank you to the attendants for all the questions.
Thank you very much. So I would also like to thank everyone for the panel for great discussions, wonderful presentations. And as mentioned, it's very rewarding to learn how your work is contributing to more integrated imaging, more integrated diagnosis, and also more individualized decision making. And of course, I would also like to thank the audience. You've been wonderful. And we're very happy that we were able to connect you with our key opinion leaders during the past few days and that we could share their experiences and that they could show how they use imaging technologies to overcome challenges and actually improve patient outcomes. Please check out our website in case you missed anything or if you'd like to know more about our technologies. And remember, never hesitate to contact us. And for now, thank you again and good night.